worship God for something that we did, that God did for you this week. We want to thank God right now. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you've done for us, Lord. Thank you for protecting us from Corona, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace, Lord. Thank you for your love and your kindness, Lord Jesus. Thank you for everything you've done for us, Lord. Thank you for protecting us on the highways and the byways. Thank you for protecting us on our jobs, Lord Jesus. Thank you for blessing our children, Lord. Thank you for blessing our loved ones, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done, all that you did, Lord Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Join in with me. Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for being so good to me. So good to me. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. Help me sing it, y'all. Lord, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for being so good to me. Good to me. Oh, you bread when I was hungry. Do I have a witness? Water when I got thirsty. You've been my shelter in the time of a storm. And you never ever left me alone. I want to thank you for being so good to me. So good to me. Help me one more time. Say, Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. Oh, Lord, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for being so good to me. So good to me. Amen. I am pleased this morning to have one of my colleagues slash big sisters in the gospel who is going to come and preach the word. But before she comes, we do have a liturgical dance ministry. I'm glad to have Lady Mickles with us. She is with us on this morning. She's going to come once I finish introducing the speaker. So I'm going to introduce the speaker. Lady Mickles is going to come, and then following her will be our speaker. But Suffragan Bishop Monica Parchia Price and I have become well acquainted with each other in recent months, and I'm glad to have connected with her. We've done missions work together over in Puerto Rico. Some of you remember this past January, we were over in Puerto Rico. Seems like it was so long ago in light of everything that has transpired, but she brought her daughter Tiffany, and they were also a part of our medical mission team of what we did in Puerto Rico. Many of you are familiar with her because she is the daughter of the late Bishop Earl Parchia of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and those of you who are long-term members here at Bethesda Temple Church know that Bishop Parchia and Bishop James A. Johnson were very close friends, and so there's a lot of history between these two families, and she is with us on today. I am going to take time just to read her bio. Someone asked me, why do we read speakers' bios? Well, because you need to know who's standing up here pouring into you. You need to know what qualifies them to be able to speak into your life. And so I'm going to read this very briefly and then I'll move out of the way. As a Levite, Monica Parchia Price is no stranger to worship, for she lives, breathes, and embodies it. That's true. As an ardent worshiper and ordained elder, she has worked in various kingdom capacities: preacher and teacher of the word, worship leader, Sunday school teacher, treasurer, youth leader, minister of music, and regional mass choir director of the Minnesota-Wisconsin-Dakota's Council.
She studied journalism and public relations at the University of Wisconsin in Milwaukee and urban ministries at the Milwaukee Theological Institute. As a journalist, she produced and hosted the community affairs television program Pushing for Excellence, where she interviewed Oprah Winfrey, Les Brown, and other personalities. And I will add to that, she interviewed me on yesterday. Accepting the call to ministry, she has ministered, preached, and traveled across the country and abroad in the Caribbean, throughout Europe, Africa, and Israel. In 2000, she was recruited to work for a church and legal management firm in Brooklyn, New York. And after several years in New York, in the New Jersey area, God impressed upon her to return to her roots in Milwaukee, where she assisted her father, Bishop Earl Parchia, in ministry. After caring for her father for the last 18 months of his life, she witnessed his demise and transition. Suffragan Bishop Parchia Price now continues the legacy of her father and recent demise of her mother, Dr. Cora Parchia, whom both founded Mount Zion Assembly of the Apostolic Faith Church Incorporated. This also entails overseeing the educational and fiscal responsibilities of the Early View Academy of Excellence K-12, which is the educational ministry of Mount Zion, as it employs 45 and educates over 400 scholars. She also serves as a board member of the Prevent Blindness Milwaukee, an organization aimed to providing children with vision impairments the ability to see. She's received a master's degree in chaplaincy in 2016 and a doctorate in 2017 from the International Police and Fire Chaplain Association, Bible College, and Seminary. Suffragan Bishop Parchia Price was elevated to District Elder, which she oversees the churches in her district. She was appointed to this honor by her Bishop, Bishop Richard Howell, under the auspices of the parent body of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World Incorporated, former presiding prelate at the time, Bishop Charles Ellis. She currently serves as the first vice chair of the Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Dakota Council. Her most recent appointment is that of the office of Suffragan Bishop, in which she was consecrated in October of 2019 under Bishop Howell and the MWDDC and presiding Bishop Theodore Brooks of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. She loves the people of God, and she is happily married to Elder Ricky Price. Ladies and gentlemen, those of you tuning in, it is my pleasure to introduce to you, after our liturgical dance ministry by the lovely Lady Mickles, Suffragan Bishop Monica Parchia Price.
Simply says, Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Lord. Sister Cherise Nelson.
thank him, I thank him. Is anybody grateful this morning for just being able to open your mouth and say, thank you? Oh, my God, my God, my God. God has been so good to us. God has been so good to us. I said, God has been so good to us. Amen, amen. I'm so thankful, amen, for the ministry, the mind ministry of our dear sister. God is so good. It is an extreme honor to be here this morning. It is extreme honor. I won't go into, I didn't know you were going to read my entire bio. I'm going to have to come up with an abridged version. Amen. God bless you. God bless you to Pastor Johnson and to Lady Johnson in her absence. I just want to thank the Lord for what he has done for me. If you would just give me a few minutes, preachers say that all the time. We don't plan before you too long. But I'm going to let God have his way. Is that all right this morning? I'm going to let God have his way. I'm going to go to the scripture and then we'll do that. We're going to go to Mark, the fourth chapter, giving honor to the legacy of Bishop Johnson and to, I see Sister Jackie, God bless you. Amen, amen. We thank God. Thank God for my husband, Elder Ricky Price. Thank God for my daughter accompanying me. And I'm so glad that God has allowed us to come for such a time as this. The 33rd verse you'll find us, and with many such parables, spake he the word unto them as they were able to hear it. He did not tell them anything about a parable, but privately to his disciples, I'm reading for the Amplified Version, you can follow along in whatever version you have. Those who were peculiarly his own, he explained everything fully. On that same day, when the evening had come, he said to them, let us go over to the other side of the lake. And leaving the throng, they took him with them, just as he was in the boat in which he was sitting. And the other boats were with him. And a furious storm of wind of hurricane proportions arose, and the waves kept beating the boat so that it was already becoming filled. But he himself was in the stern of the boat, or the bottom of the boat, asleep on the cushion, and they awoke him and said to him, Master, do you not care that we are dying? Do you not care that we are perishing? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, hush now, peace be still. And the wind ceased, it sank to the rest as if exhausted by its own beating. And there was immediately a great calm, a perfect peaceness. And he said to them, why are you so timid and fearful? How is it that you have no faith? How come you are not firmly relying upon me? And they were filled with great awe and feared exceedingly, and said to one another, who then is this that even the wind and sea obey him? King James Version says, what manner of man is this that even the wind and sea obey him? My subject this morning is, his promises will take you through the storm. His promises will take you through the storm. You are here, moving in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, changing lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, transforming lives. I worship you. I worship you. maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Come on, if you know him to be a waker maker, lift your hands. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. I'm so glad you're a waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Oh, my God, that is who you are. One more time, how many know him to be a waymaker?
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
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 Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm so glad that he's a way maker. That means he makes a way when there is no way. That means he creates something that was not formerly there. He's a way maker. Hallelujah. Wherever you are, sitting in your living room, those of us who are in the sanctuary, we feel the presence of God in this place. And I hope that in your home, in your car, you will have him in your atmosphere. And then just see what happens when you worship him. You invite him in. For the Bible says he dwells in the midst of praises. He inhabits the praises of his people. Because that's who he is. That's who he is. Hallelujah, hallelujah. This story, this account of the Lord in the boat with his disciples. The Lord has gifted us a place in history, especially during this pandemic season, that where we must be the church and not just merely attend one. We are the bride of Christ. He's calling us and he's pulling on everything that he put in us to represent him. He doesn't want us to merely talk about faith. He doesn't want us to just preach about faith. He doesn't want us to just teach about faith. But he wants us to walk in faith. Better yet, let's just be faith. And be faithful. This is the church's finest hour to rise up and be his bride, telling a dying world about the power of Jesus Christ. We must show forth his power in every place. 2 Corinthians reminds us, he tells us to now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. In other words, he changes the variables to cause us to triumph. He changes what would have taken you out. He changes that so you will now triumph. I love that about God. He says, for unto God a sweet smelling savor, not savior. He is the savior. But we are a sweet savor unto Christ. In other words, in every situation, we need to remind God of himself. What does that mean? What does that mean? Through us, he brings knowledge of Christ. And everywhere we go, people breathe in his aroma through us. Everywhere we go, people breathe in his exquisite fragrance by who we are. Because of Christ, we give off a sweet scent of God. That means everywhere you go, people should smell God. Everywhere you go, they should see the love of God in you. I'm going somewhere with this. So when he smells us, our works, our habits, even our faith, it should be pleasing to God. You ought to smell good to God. Tell somebody, I smell good to God. Mm-hmm, God, I smell good to God. I smell good to God. The Hebrew writer admonishes us, for without faith, it is impossible to please God, because everyone who comes to him must believe that he exists. Huh? That he is, and that he is a rewarder to those who earnestly or diligently seek him. I tell my church all the time, God is touched by our tears, but he's really moved by our faith. Yes, as a high priest, he's touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Yes, he's concerned about your situation. Yes, he's concerned about your physical and your mental well-being. Yes, he's moved with compassion. Yes, he understands your struggle. Yes, he understands your anger with the system. He understands your needs. He supplies them, but faith is what pleases him. Faith is what makes him stand up. Faith is what makes him intercede on your behalf. Faith is what makes him heal the sick and raise the dead. Faith is what moves him to provide for you. When your faith rises up, it makes him stand up. When your faith rises up, it makes him say, somebody is trusting and believing in me. Somebody knows I can take them through. I'm impressed with your faith. I'm not impressed with your tears. Even during this season of turmoil, even through this season of strife and sickness and disease, diverse political agendas and upheavals and dissension, God must still be glorified. We're talking about faith and he on the boat. When we look at this text, our scriptures, we find a situation where in spite of the lack of faith, Jesus is still glorified. We read this account in the Synoptic Gospels. Matthew talks about it in the 8th chapter. Mark talks about it in the 4th chapter. And Luke talks about it in the 8th chapter. And they all have their own take on what happens. According to Matthew, Luke, Mark, one day Jesus had been teaching to the multitudes. Matthew states, he goes on to chronicle everything that had happened in the chapter. Matthew states that even before they set sail, these are all the things that Jesus did. He performed miracles. He healed a leper who fell down and worshiped him. Then he healed the centurion's servants. And the centurion's servant said, even at thy word, I know you can heal my servant. Jesus said, I have not found so great a faith in Israel. We're talking about faith and taking us through the storm. Then he goes on to Peter's house and walks in the house, and Peter's mother-in-law is sick. He heals her, and she wakes up, and she comes up, and she starts to minister to him. The Bible goes on to say, by the evening, they brought him many that were possessed with devils. He cast out the spirit with his word and healed all that were sick. This is all that happened before they even set sail. Then Luke, the physician, a detailed writer, talks about all the things that he had done. He gives explicit details of Jesus' tremendous actions that he cast out the demon of Mary Magdalene. He spoke about the parables about the sower and the sower seeds. This is all before he got into the boat. Later in the chapter, Jesus is surrounded by so many people that his mothers and his brothers tried to get through the crowd. And people were like, Lord, your mom is here to see you. He said, who is my mother? Who is my father? Those that obey me and do my will, those that acknowledge my word, that is my family. So here we are in the text, Mark's account. He also taught in the parables about the sower and the seed. I'm going somewhere with this. But they all agree, all of the gospels agree that by evening time, he was tired. Can you imagine putting yourself in Jesus' shoes? He had healed the sick and done this and done that. And physically, see, in his divinity, he was healing and casting out devils. But as a man, he was tired. Or as I say, tired. The Bible says if you would just think about all the things that happened in that chapter, Jesus was physically tired, worn out, exhausted. Anybody tired and worn out? You're tired and worn out because of what's happening, not because of what you do. Jesus had got through healing the sick and doing all those things, and so he was tired. He was anointed to do those things in his divinity, but thank God that he was a man. He understood that sometimes we get tired. He's been healing and preaching folk all day long, and so he gets into the boat. He needed so much sleep that it seems that the storm didn't even awaken him. Imagine being fast asleep, brothers and sisters, and being awake and very rudely, and people are frantic and freaking out and waking you up. Have you ever been in a deep sleep and somebody comes and wakes you up and it jolts you and it shocks you? Well, nothing surprised Jesus because he was the creator of the sea. So nothing shocks Jesus. When you're going through what you're going through, it doesn't shock him. He knows all about it. The Bible says we can just imagine how Jesus must have felt when his disciples are freaking out. He finally gets up and seemingly unaware of their fright. He's seemingly unaware of their distress. He's sleeping. Seemingly, he's unaware of their fear. I keep saying seemingly because he knows all things. Jesus, you don't know what I'm going through. He seemingly is unaware of the pandemic. Somebody help me in here. Seemingly, he's unaware of the unemployment in the line. Seemingly, he's unaware of the political lies in the media. Seemingly, he's unaware of the injustices and brutality in the land. It seems like he doesn't care. Master, carest thou not that we perish? Don't you see what I'm going through, God? Children running amok, people in jail, people are being unjustly accosted on the street. People are dying in the street at the hands of the police brutality system. I'm not going to get political, but it is what it is. Lord, seemingly, it seems like you don't know what's going on. Carest thou not that we perish? Seems like he doesn't care, but if you really know God, you know his mission and that he cares. Finally, they couldn't take the rocking and reeling anymore. They were experienced fishermen, and they did what they could until the point they couldn't do anymore, and they had to wake him up. See, sometimes we get to the point, we do, well, Lord, I'm going to do what I can. Then I'll wait till I'm on my last leg, and then I'll call you for help. They did what they could as experienced fishermen. They got the rope and did what they had to do, but the Bible says their water has started to fill the boat. Now they are panicking. Anybody feel like you drowning sometimes? Feel like you're drowning. They couldn't take the water being in the boat anymore. And they said to him, Teacher, Master, Rabboni, don't you care that we are perishing? Matthew and Mark say, carest thou not that we perish? In other words, Lord, how can you see what's going on and abandon me? Anybody going through something in your life and you feel like, Lord, I know you know what's going on. Lord, you see what's going on. You see I don't have a job. You see that my children are on drugs. You see that my daughter's having 12 babies by 12 different. Come on, somebody. You see what's going on, but somehow in our humanity, we don't feel like Jesus is seeing what's going on because he's not moving as quickly as we want him to move. Lord, how can you see what's going on and not do anything about it? Lord, how can people be hungry and poor in a land where the richest soil and gold exist in Africa? Lord, how can we live in a superpower named America where millionaires are plenty, but many live beneath their privilege? Come on, somebody. How is it happening? Lord, if you said you're going to the other side, why doesn't it seem like we're going to make it? Why does it seem like the enemy has the upper hand? Why does it seem like the wicked are prospering? Why does it seem like the righteous seems to suffer? You promised to take us to the other side, but why does it seem like we're going to drown before we get there? Anybody ever been in the middle of a situation and you feel like you're going to drown? You say, Lord, I know you see what's going on, but I feel like I'm drowning. Look, even in another account, Peter had enough sense to say, Lord, if it's you out there, bid me come, because if you say come, I can make it. If you say come on, I can take it. My God, my God. And some of us in the middle of this pandemic season, we don't know. Some of us don't know what's going on and we're panicking. Those of us who know Jesus is already on board, we don't have to panic because we already know the outcome. But there are many that are coming to the church, Bishop. I said, Bishop, all right. Many are coming to the church, and we have to extend to them that there is hope on the other side. But you got to navigate through the waters of poverty sometime. You have to navigate through the waters of uncertainty. We know he's going to take us to the other side. The whiners used to sing a song, in the meantime. We don't know what's going on, but that interim period is where God keeps reminding us, you are my child. I love you. You are my daughter. You are my son. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And we've got to hold fast to that which is good. God said, I'm not going to leave you. You just got to hang on in there, because I'm already on board. I'm going to pull you through the storm. Lord. They didn't ask him. I noticed that. They didn't ask him to stop the storm. They indicted him by asking him, don't you care about me? Don't you, master? They didn't say, master, stop the storm. They indicted him by saying, carest thou not that we're going to die? So they had a self-centered view of the storm. They didn't understand, like, this is not about you. This is not about what you're going through, because if I'm with you, you obviously don't know who's on board. When you really know who's on board, you don't panic easily. You don't freak out. You don't get upset. You gotta know who's on board with you. You gotta know who's walking beside you. You gotta know who's with you. Hallelujah. Instead of going through the storm and asking God, Lord, what do you want me to learn through this storm? How can I calm the storm myself? Lord, how can I calm the storm myself? Teach me what it has to happen. How can I speak to the elements with authority? Ask God, instead of taking me out the storm, teach me how I can speak to the elements and have them obey. Come on, somebody. When you have the power of the Holy Ghost, God has given you the authority to speak to the wind. God has given you the authority to speak to your situation. God has given you the authority to speak to your own cry. Sometimes our fear is talking louder than our faith. Sometimes our fear is screaming, and our faith seems like this, and our fear is like this. But that means you don't know who has the sea under control. That means you don't know who's really navigating the waters. He may seem asleep to you, but he's fully aware of what you're going through. He's fully aware. Many of us are still asking God to do things for us instead of, how can I change the storm? Because I know you're with me. Because I know you're a promise keeper. I know you kept your word. Now remember, he already told them, let's go to the other side. He prophesied and they didn't even get it. If God says you're going to make it through that, why are you discombobulated in the interim trauma? If God already told you you're going to survive, and you're not just going to survive, you're going to thrive, then you have to keep those promises in your mind, like, Lord, I'm going through right now, but you promised me, Lord. I may be going through a personal pandemic. Let me tell you, some of us had some pandemics before the pandemic. We had some pre-pandemic issues. And God said, I know you're hurting right now, but I'm not taking you through to break you. I'm taking you through to make you. So when you get to the other side of this, you'll learn how to praise me through the pandemic. When you get on the other side of this, you'll praise me through the storm, because I promise never to leave you or forsake you. Bible said they were filled with great awe. He woke up, he rebuked the wind, and he said to the wind, peace be still. And the wind subsided. The Bible says in one translation, there was a dead calm. What is a dead calm? You go from a tumultuous situation to all of a sudden a calmness. Nobody can do that but Jesus. Nobody can have you be topsy-turvy and all of a sudden he just went. Have you ever been into a car accident? Or it may not snow and ice like it does in Wisconsin, but you can be on an ice patch and screaming Jesus and all of a sudden your car stop. That's what that's like when God will suddenly deliver you. God will suddenly make a way out of no way. God will suddenly heal your body. God will suddenly give you the finances you need. Out of nowhere there comes a storm, but I've already said we're going to the other side. Sometimes we feel, the Lord said, he said to them, why are you afraid? Have you no faith? See, I want to say, let me just go in my human mind. With them being on the boat with him, they almost didn't need to have faith because they had him. They had him. They had seen him just that day cast out devils. I'm not talking about weeks ago. I mean that day. And all synoptic gospels say that in the evening they went in the boat to the other side. So they had just seen him perform miracles. How then is it that God, we've seen God move on our behalf, and yet we don't know if we us gonna make it? God, you've seen God create finances for you. You've seen God heal your children. You've seen God just bring you through. And yet we are so quick to panic when we don't see him. That's when you have to trust him when you can't trace him. That's when you gotta trust his word. Lord, I don't see it, but it's not for me to see, because faith doesn't always see. Faith just knows. Faith just believes. Sometimes when we look at the faith, God said, have you no faith? And so Luke says, Jesus said, where is your faith? Matthew said, have you no faith? But it's all about them not showing the faith that they should have. Sometimes we feel that if we could see Jesus and touch him and talk to him like his disciples, that our faith would be stronger. Look, yet they were with him. They were within feet of Jesus, and they still had a little faith. It doesn't matter with you whether you were a disciple hanging out with Jesus or whether you're just a kid in the 21st century, huh? You have to have the faith that God will move on your behalf. We have to constantly remind ourselves that we serve a promise keeper. So when you're going through your personal storm, that's why you have to have the word on the inside. We all love music. I was a minister of music. We love music. But let me tell you, unless you have that word on the inside, the devil is not intimidated by what he created with the temperance in his body. You know, in Ezekiel, Lucifer, son of the morning, had all the instruments here, so he can't be impressed by what he does. You feel me? So faith is what moves God. The songs of Zion are so important, but the word is what transforms storms. The word is what transforms lives. The word is what transforms your mentality into knowing that, God, if you take me through this, I know I can go through that. Is there anybody that knows what I'm talking about? This teaches us that even the followers of Jesus, they had their own issues. As followers of God, we have our own issues. Just because we're followers and disciples of Jesus, it doesn't mean that we don't have storms in our life. And I was talking to Pastor Johnson yesterday how even through this pandemic season, many ministers and pastors are giving up and resigning. And I had a couple brothers call me and say, you know, sis, I think I'm just going to give this up and resign. I said, you can't give up now, bro. Resign and retire after we come out of this, because the saints need somebody to show them some hope. The saints need somebody to know there is a God in Israel. The world is looking for the sons of God to manifest themselves in every place in the earth. The earth is looking for hope, and so we cannot back up and retreat, even though many of us are worn out. That's a secret. People look at the church and say, what is the church doing? We talked about that yesterday. The Lord told us to pray. I'm not saying you can't protest, but our first job is to hear from God. Our first job, yes, we'll march. Yes, we're part of the protesting. I believe in the power of a protest. But our first responsibility is, Lord, what are you saying to the church? Lord, as we go through this water, as we navigate through the storm, what are you saying to us, oh God? What are you saying to the church? He's still saying, when I return to the earth, will I find faith? Will I find my scent? Will I find the sweet smeller that is attractive to me as God? Will I find faith in the earth? The purpose of the storm, even as we serve this promise keeper, the purpose of the storm, brothers and sisters, isn't to take you out, but it's to build your character. Remember, the enemy is not fighting you because you're weak. The enemy is fighting you because you have purpose. Not because you're weak, oh Lord, he's fighting you because you have purpose in God, and he knows that. The Bible says that Jesus was on board the whole time, yet they didn't know who he was. You know how I was thinking about this, and I got another nugget from the Lord. They obviously marveled, and they didn't know who he was. And I said, Lord, how did they walk with you and talk with you and eat with you and sleep? They were together and they still didn't know who he was. Can I be myself this morning? Too late. They marveled, and Matthew said, they said to each other in awe, who is this guy? Who is this dude? Who is this dude that he speaks to the wind and the wind is stopped tripping? Who is this dude that the waves are, we got all this water in the boat. Who is this dude that he can just speak to the wind and the elements? They clearly, and this is the nugget I got even last night, they clearly did not walk in sonship. When the Lord showed me that last night, I said, ooh-wee. They didn't walk in their sonship. What parent, what child doesn't know who their parent is? What parent doesn't reveal their self to the child? He was revealing himself to them all the time. Everywhere he went, everything he said, he was revealing them. They marveled. They didn't walk into the sonship. They really didn't know who they had on board. They knew Jesus was a good guy. They thought he was a cool dude, healing the sick, raising the dead, moving compassion on the poor, feeding thousands of people. But they couldn't possibly know, as a son would know his father is on board, that everything would be all right. It was clear they didn't realize that the creator of the elements was on board, and he knew the language of the wind and sea. When the Lord showed me that, I just start screaming. I said, Lord, if we really know who you are, we wouldn't panic at the first time trouble come. If we really know who you are, we wouldn't trip out the first signs of trouble. My father used to love to tell a story about a young lad who was on a train, and his father was conducting the train, and he was way ahead on a different car. And all of a sudden, the train started rocking and reeling, seemingly like it was going to derail. And everybody was panicking, pulling their hair out. And the child was just sitting there swinging his legs and looking out the window. And they said, we're about to derail. Don't you know what's getting ready to happen? Why aren't you upset? He said, my father is the conductor, and I trust him. I said, Lord, you are the conductor on this train. There's nothing that we have to be afraid of. There's nothing we have to panic and trip out over. You are our conductor. My God, hallelujah. How does a son not know the capabilities of his father? That's why Jesus said, where is your faith? In other words, I already told you we're going to the other side. I said I will bring it to pass because I'm a promise keeper. What has God promised you? Do you not trust him? Hasn't he been good to us? Hasn't he made a way out of no way? That's why I wanted to sing that song, because we have to remind ourselves he's a promise keeper. He's not just a promise maker. Many of us have had people in our lives promise us things and they couldn't come through. Sometimes they wanted to come through, but they just couldn't. Sometimes because they didn't have the ability. Sometimes because they didn't have the wherewithal. But honey, if God said it, it's going to happen. If God said it, he's going to bring it to pass. If God said it, he's going to come to fruition. I love telling the story. When my husband and I were courting, we were kind of walking through the park, and we like to go on long walks. We like to be, years ago, clear, I put on a little more girth since then, praise the Lord. He has increased my borders, praise the Lord. And so he said, come on, jump on my back. Come on, this was years ago. Come on, jump on my back. I said, no, I'm not going to jump on your back. You don't, and he got indignant. You don't trust me? I said, that's a tough one. It's not that I don't trust you. I don't trust your ability to hold me. So in other words, when you cast your cares on him, the Bible said he careth for you. Anything you can throw at Jesus, he can handle it. Anything you give to God, he knows what to do. Anything you can give to Jesus, that's why he said, give me everything you got. I'll turn it around and make it good. As I conclude this, let us always be reminded that he takes us through our storms. It's always to help somebody else. When God is bringing you through, I'm going to read the next verse of that, because that was the part that got me. We read to the end of the chapter, but the next chapter in Mark, the fifth chapter, verse 1 says, and they came over to the other side of the sea and into the country of Gadarenes. And so when you realize, I wanted to say that because that was the finality of it. He said, if I said it's going to happen, it's going to happen. The Bible says that they came to the other side. And sometimes we are so selfish that we cannot see God moving in our midst. We cannot see what God is doing because we are focusing on the problem instead of the problem solver. We're focusing on the lack instead of the surplus. We're focusing on what we don't have instead of what he has. We're focusing on us instead of who he is. We're focusing on the wrong thing instead of saying, Lord, if you said it, it's going to come to pass. I may not see it. I may not understand it. Sometimes God does things in our life we don't even agree with if we tell him the truth. But Lord, if you said it, I know you're going to bring it to pass because I trust you. Hallelujah. Everything that you go through, it's always to show forth his glory, his purpose in your life. Now, when Jesus got to the other side, this is my conclusion. When Jesus got to the other side, the disciples were able to witness the casting of demons of the man who was known as a cutter. He cut himself. The Bible says he was in the grave. He couldn't be contained, so he lived in the wilderness because nobody wanted to fool with him. Anybody ever, in before your saved life, anybody want to fool with you? Never mind. Don't raise your hand. This man was in turmoil. He was in such turmoil. His family didn't want to have anything to do with him. The Bible says every time they put chains on him, he would come out the chain. He had such demonic strength that he could bring out the chain and just come out. The Bible says that the disciples were able to witness God casting those demons out. When he got his right mind, the Bible says, that's when we get the scripture, he was clothed. Y'all say clothed in his right mind. No, he wasn't clothed. He was clothed, meaning he had on clothing, and found in his right mind. And I said, now, had God taken you out through the storm, brothers and sisters, you can just think back in your own storm. Had God taken you out of your storm and caused you to die in your storm, you couldn't witness the miracle on the side of the next chapter of your life. There's another chapter that God has for you, but you can't be bogged down with what's going on in the storm. He said, I've got another chapter for you. If you can make it to the storm, you'll have the victory. If you could just make it to the other side, I've got some things I want to show you, Peter. I've got some things I want to show you, John, but you got to make it to the other side. When he cast the demons out, and the Bible says the man was found clothed and in his right mind, the Bible says he began to bow down and worship Jesus. And he said, I want to go with you. Now that I'm saved, now that I'm redeemed, I want to go with you. He said, no, you can't go with me. I need you to go back and tell your family. Go back and tell somebody, I'm healed, I'm delivered, I'm set free. God promised to take us through the storm. I don't know what storm you're in. In my absolute clothing, in closing, everything has to point back to God. The storm is in your life so you can point back to what Jesus did. The storm is in your life for you to point to your unsaved loved ones who's watching. It's not just that you're going through, it's how you go through what you're going through. The storm is there to show you and make you and mold you. So when you come on the other side, you can be a witness. Everything has to point back to God. That's why, beloved, you can't die in the storm. There's a testimony. You have to show the power of God that's keeping you as a living testimony and being a promise keeper. Our Father and our God, we thank you for being with us in this storm. This pandemic is only making us greater disciples for you. You are a promise keeper. And we thank you for this storm that you're allowing us to go through, to be a witness of your grace and your mercy. We thank you for this storm that you brought us through. Help us to realize that you are on board with us, that we are not by ourselves. Because you promised to take us to the other side. On the other side of the storm is a miracle. On the other side of the storm are blessings. On the other side of the storm are things that you want us to witness, see, and even do. For you said, greater works shall we do. Thank you for preserving us, oh God, through the storm, the storms of life. God, forgive us for not having the faith to believe you when you said you would take us through. Give us faith, oh God, that can move mountains, but everything we do must point back to you. We thank you for this time. Thank you for being a way maker. Thank you for being us, giving us storm chasing demon power. We have the power within us to be demon chasers. We don't run from the demons. They run from us. Thank you for being a way maker. Thank you, oh God, for the word. Whoever's watching, I pray that they would realize they have the power within them to make it through the storm. Not because of our own ability, but because you are on board. Not because we're great and fantastic, because we're not. But because that we walk with you and you talk with us. Thank you for being the promise keeper. And that you are taking us to the other side of through. Thank you for taking us to the other side of the storm. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you.
love of Jesus. Not death, no life. Jesus paid the price, now I'm free from sin. I am sold out. My mind is made up. I am sold out. My mind is made up. I come through the fire, I come through the rain. But God, He never left my side. He's my comfort through all hurt and pain.